My name is Andreea, if someone who doesn't know this yet. I'm Romanian. However, I feel international. And that's because I've been living in so many places and I've been able to adapt to different social and geographical environments. The way I see the talk today, instead of having a speech with you listening, I would actually like to have more of an interactive discussion about career planning and, you know, those hard things like what's going to happen in the future, what are you actually going to do, those hard questions that people tend to ask you and you tend to be like, I've been done that, right? So you might wonder why I'm here from the other corner of the world trying to tell you what you have to do with your life. Actually, I'm not. I'm just going to try to tell you the story of what I've done so far in order to motivate or some kind of inspire you in what you want to do. I'm 25, in case you wonder that. I know it's not normal for a girl or a woman to tell her age, but I don't really care about that. I'm kind of with that. I think after I get up, after I pass 30, I'm kind of stressed about it. Okay. So I'm 25, almost 36. And so far, I've lived in like 4 countries, visited more other, and interacted with many people from many different cultures. I do speak 6 languages, but that's not because I stayed in school and studied them all the time, but because I realized that the only way in which you can actually understand and get a culture is by speaking its language as well. And by understanding the role of it and the importance of studying the language, that's how I got into speaking them. And you know, when you start speaking someone else's language, you show that you respect that person. And to be honest, I'm very happy when someone speaks Romanian with me. It doesn't happen very often from a foreigner. But however, I still feel very happy when someone speaks with me my native language. So I can somehow understand how the other people feel when I speak with them in their native language. And that makes me understand how languages are important. However, languages are also important throughout my studies. Because if you want to follow an academic life, you need to do a lot of research. And knowing more than one language makes you a better researcher, in a way that you can actually access more information in different languages and you can actually check the information you get. That's the same with journalism, you know? The best journalists are the ones that can actually check their information through different resources in different languages. So it's not just academia that uses languages, it's even more than that. But how do I get to languages and politics and Middle East history and terrorism, because that's exactly what I'm working on. When I was a child, I was actually born in Romania after communism, just a year after Ceausescu was killed. So coming to life in a community that is just trying to get into a new pathway after communism is kind of a hard job. However, I had the chance to grow up in a society that was in the same way following the path of the European Union. So my school and afterwards high school was involved in kind of international projects that were supposed to make us think international. So since an early age, I had a contact with gap teachers, teachers of English from different corners of the world, from Canada, USA, UK, who were coming to Romania to teach us English. And that was the first click that made me understand how important languages is, and at the same time, that maybe fall in love somehow with the English and American culture. I think that was the moment when I realized that I would like to study at some point in England or the USA. I eventually chose the UK because of the fact that it's closer to my home country. However, this also made me realize that experiences that we have in our life, no matter how important or unimportant we think they are, they actually make us who we are in the present. So, I started up in a very small town back in Romania, very, very far away from the capital city, with no real prospect if you look at it. However, I had the chance to have amazing teachers from my own country and from abroad as well. Teachers are extremely important in our lives, and that's why I decided to become a teacher in the future as well, because I know what they can do. They have the most amazing power of our world today, because they are forming the future world. Afterwards, after I learned English, I managed to get a scholarship into an international high school, a private high school back in my home country, the best one in my home country. However, being a private one, I needed a scholarship to get into it, and I got it because I really wanted, from a very early age, I knew exactly what I wanted to do. And let me tell you, let me underline this thing, the most important thing is to know what you want to do, to define exactly what you want. You actually have, I know some of you might have read The Secret. I thought it was just stupid literature at first. However, I do believe that if you know exactly what to tell the universe to give you, it ends up giving it to you. But you have to know how to ask it, and you have to know exactly what you want. So I wanted to get into that high school, I did it, and that opened many, many doors to me. I started learning Spanish and Turkish at the same time. Turkish went better than Spanish, though. Although Spanish is closer to my native language. I learned Turkish, I went into international competitions, and I ended up being the first European who spoke Turkish at the intermediate level. Afterwards, in my classroom appeared two new faces, and they were from Iraq. And I started listening to the Arab language, and it sounded very familiar. I know how odd it might seem. However, this made me realize that I might like studying Arabic. So the first thing I did, I started researching on the internet courses on Arabic language back in Bucharest, because that's the capital city of Romania, and that's where my high school used to be. And I found some. It was pretty hard to attend them because they were in the evening. But no one could stop me. I did it. I went there. But at the same time, I got involved in another project. I know some of you might know about it. It's the MUN here in the US, Model United Nations. In Europe, we have a different one. It's Model European Union, basically. It is called UIP, European Youth Parliament. In my high school, I was the first one who got into that project. But I made it sure that after me, everybody is going to join me. And now, that project became like a tradition back in our high school. However, having those Arabic classes together with this project, European Youth Parliament, moving from one country to another, like every month I was just skipping classes to go to a meeting somewhere. I know, it's not good, but still, it really made an improvement in my skills and studies. Having those both at the same time made me actually realize what I want to do after. And I started searching on the internet, joint degrees. Degrees that could let me do Arabic languages, like Arabic and Turkish, together with politics. And it happened that in the United Kingdom, I found 5 universities that I wanted to join. I applied to all of them. I got accepted into all of them. However, I chose the Exeter University, and there is just one reason. I wanted to go to the Middle East as fast as possible, and the Exeter University used to give that opportunity in the second year of your studies. So again, you need to know what you want, right? You need to know what you ask the university to give you, and you need to know what you want, because you need to know what to do to get what you want. So I ended up in the UK, at the Exeter University, studying Arabic and Middle East studies. Actually, it was Arabic and politics at first. See, I had some moments when I didn't really know what I want. See, so yeah, it happens. It happens to all of us. However, I was lucky enough to get it straight on the line immediately. And in my second semester, I changed to Middle East studies together with Arabic. At the same time, my mom's a lawyer. I've next to her, like, since I was a very, like, little child, in her office all the time, looking at what she's doing, hearing to her talks with her, you know, her clients. So I said, why not try, you know, studying law at the same time? So back in my home country, you could get a law degree from distance. So I started 2 degrees at the same time. Although I was in England, every time in the summer I used to go back home to give my exams for my law degree. These two worked perfectly. However, the English experience, university experience, next to the Romanian university experience, they are extremely different. The perspectives, the things that they want from you, those are extremely different. And then the Syrian experience appeared. In my second year of my studies, I was supposed to choose where I want to go to do my year abroad for my Arabic language. And I was supposed to choose from Syria, Egypt, Jordan, and Tunisia. And because of its proximity to Turkey, I think, I already spoke Turkish at a like fluent level, I chose Syria. I think it was because I felt closer to Syria than I felt to other Arab countries. And it was the best choice of my life, I think. Not just because I had the chance to see Syria just before it got destroyed, and believe me, it's an amazing country. And my heart cries every time I look on TV and I see one more place destroyed in an amazing, like the history that you get in Syria. You see it destroyed right now. And my heart, you know, when I see that, my heart cries. However, Syria is an amazing country. It gives you an amazing hospitality. So I managed to adapt easily. That's why I'm saying that it was the best choice regarding my studies. My year abroad in Syria not only lets me improve my Arabic and especially my speaking Arabic, because that's what you get there, you need to learn the dialect, but also made me realize what the Arab culture really means, what the Arab people really are, the way they think, the way they see things, and the way they look at us, not only the way I look at them, but we look at them. And this really helps me in my research today, my experience then. Remember what I was telling you, that's something that I underlined yesterday in my presentation as well. The experiences that we have every single moment of our life, every single little decision that we make, it makes such a difference in our life. It can take us from one place to another immediately, although we are not aware of it. We need to be aware of that. We need to be aware that every single thing that we do, or every single thing that we want, makes who we are in the present and in the future as well. The Syrian experience, it was amazing. It was, I think, the best year of my studies. I couldn't finish my year there because of the revolution. I couldn't give my exams. I had to go all the way back to England in the summer to take my exams. However, every single day there taught me something. Apart from teaching me Arabic, taught me the power of a united community, taught me the power of culture and multiculturality, taught me that Arabs are not that different from us. They are humans like we are. They might love the same things, they might like the same things. They actually don't see us as enemies. They actually understand more than we do. So it made me appreciate them more and more. Coming back to England and continuing my degrees in both Arabic, being a joint degree, I was continuing my degree both in Arabic and in the Middle East studies, made me realize what I actually want to do next. And I got more and more interested in the conflicts in the Middle East, being in the Palestinian conflict and afterwards the revolutions and the crisis in Syria, Egypt, Tunisia, Libya, and the list may go on, unfortunately. And that's the moment when I decided that. Oh, at the same time, I had the chance, the opportunity to take a mediation course back in my home country. And having all those things like the degree, the mediation course made me look at conflict from different perspectives. And this was very important in the way I was supposed to choose what I'm going to do next. So when I was going to choose my master's, the first thing that I saw, even though there was a very long list, I saw Master's of Research in Security, Conflict, and Justice. And those three words, they were exactly what I wanted. I was interested in security because I was interested in conflict, and you can't have security without conflict, and conflict without security. And then I was interested in justice because I've always thought about it. I've always thought of what justice really means. And to be honest, I still can't give you an answer about that. Yeah, bearing in mind that I took the law courses, bearing in mind that I finished my degree and my master's as well, and I'm into a PhD right now, I still can't tell you what exactly justice is. Because justice is different for, you can give a different understanding of it from any point you look. So I decided to go into my master's. Again, I knew exactly what I wanted to do. I started my master's. I realized that there is a problem in our Romanian community. Mediation, the one that I studied, I realized that it wasn't understood correctly by the Romanian population, because it was just at the start. So my thesis was focused exactly on what mediation means, the way it should apply, and what mistakes have been done in the Romanian community. And the reason why I chose this for my thesis is because I both felt the need to do something for my home country as well, and at the same time, because mediation doesn't really exist in the Arab world. So knowing how to apply it and bring it to a country would be good for me in my future research. So I finished my master's, and then the next step, a PhD, what I'm gonna do, I was thinking about it. I knew exactly what I wanted. I wanted to do something on security. I wanted to do something on terrorism. I was actually, at first I was in between Palestine and the conflict in Palestine and terrorism. And then I realized that because of what's happening nowadays, I would do better in focusing on over terrorism. And then there's been a question on my mind since I began studying the Middle East history. Why do people, normal people, choose to become terrorists? Because I've always thought that no one is born as a terrorist. People become terrorists. So thinking about this topic made me realize that that's what I actually want to research on. And there has been loads of research on this topic. However, I've always thought, and I'm sure about this, and that's another thing, you know? Let me make a parenthesis right now. Apart from knowing what you want to do, you have to believe in yourself. You have to be sure that through what you do, you're going to do something good. You're going to bring something new. And I really do believe this about my thesis and about what my work and about my research. I was telling Christopher today, we had a talk about this as well. I was telling him that when I was applying for my PhD back in my home country, I told them that I'm not planning to bring a new strategy of discovering what a terrorist is and how a person becomes a terrorist. What I'm planning to do is to bring new information that can help the intelligence services to identify terrorists. I'm not trying to change the whole strategy, I'm just trying to improve it. But I'm sure I can do that. I'm sure that the languages that I speak, the way I'm doing my research, the experiences that I had, everything can help me improve that strategy, not just for Romania, but for the whole world as well. Because terrorism is not a thing that affects just one corner of the world, instead it affects every corner of the world. So now, I'm into a PhD, writing my thesis, researching all over it. And at the same time, I do have a family, I do have a child. I'm a mother of a 7-month-old baby girl. And I'm somehow in between everything, trying to do everything. And it works, believe me, it does. You sleep less. You learn how to sleep less, but you do end up doing everything you want. wanted to do. So I think that's my story so far. And to sum it up somehow, there are the following things that I've always said in my life. First, I always knew what I wanted, and I still do. Second, I always believed in myself. And third, I always had faith that destiny, I do believe in destiny, would take me where I have to be. But still, I need to help it. And I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but I'm sure that what I'm doing today is going to improve somehow the world I'm living in. Not for myself, but for the people that are very dear to my heart, and for my baby girl, of course, because she's going to live in the near future, right? So I really want a better world for her. So I hope you got inspired from my story. You got motivated, and I'm sure you're going to do better than I did. So, yeah, you can ask me now whatever you want. I really wanted to have an interactive talk at the same time. So I kept my story short. Now it's your turn.
Can you elaborate on that?
Yes, it's because the law system of the Middle Eastern countries doesn't have the concept of mediation. You know, it happened in the Eastern countries, Eastern Europe countries as well. Romania got mediation like a few years ago. And it still hasn't applied it correctly. Turkey, for example, got mediation, but instead of applying mediation into their law system, they actually have arbitration, and they call mediation what's actually arbitration. So the concepts of mediation, arbitration, that you have in the US nowadays, they are not the same in Europe, in Eastern Europe, and they are not existent at all in most Arab countries, Middle Eastern countries. To be honest, I looked it up a lot before I applied. I looked up a lot because I didn't know exactly whether UK or US would be better for what I was planning to do. Being in an international high school did help because you would have access to information. And you know, that's the advantage of our world today. That's the advantage you all have, access to information. You don't actually need someone to come and tell you, oh, you can do that and that. No, you can do it yourself. It's just a click away from you. So that's what I did. I didn't really expect someone to come and tell me, you know, you can do this and this, and you can apply there and there. I just looked it up on my own. And I did find 5 universities that would suit me. And I looked it up on how they are expecting our applications to be. I actually ended up in helping students afterwards. After I got into university in the UK, it was because in Romania it was just the beginning of those international studies. We just entered the EU, so the gates were just open for the Armenian students to go and study in Europe, being it UK, France, or Italy, or Spain, or Germany. So the students that wanted to apply to UK afterwards, I started helping them, and for a year or two, I used to do the application. I used to help into doing the applications for the other students back in Romania. So what I did when I was a student, it was my last grade in high school. I was preparing for my exams at the same time, because we do have exams when we finish high school. And at the same time, I was researching on the way I would have to do my proposal letter, and on the way that they were expecting me to be as their student. But I've never forgotten that I have to be who I am. So I've never changed myself or what I wanted to be or the way I was for getting accepted in university. So what I did, the way I wrote that letter, it was exactly me, myself, and I. So that's how I got into it. Of course, the grades that I got in that exam were also very important. They were pretty high as well. The work that I had throughout the 4 years of high school. That was pretty high as well. Like the grades that I got during those 4 years, they were pretty high as well. So it's not just something, it's not just one step process. It's like a multitude of steps that you take, not at, in the last year of your studies, but until then, and especially then. And that's how you get into it. And again, it's something that you also do on your own, and you shouldn't expect someone to come and push you from the back saying, oh, you need to do that, you need to do that. No, no, no. That's just you. You are intelligent enough. This new generation that we all are is intelligent enough to decide for themselves and to find out for themselves what they do and how they can do it. So I think the only advice that I can have on this is to look it up on your own and discover on your own what you have to do and how you have to do it. European Parliament is a model of the European Parliament. So the way the European Parliament works, that's the way the European Youth Parliament works. In short, if you want me to explain to you, it's a non-governmental organization. You can apply and get into it from the age of 16. And it's on different levels. First is a national level. You get selected in your national level to go and participate into international conferences. I participated into my national conference and I got selected into the international sessions. And I went to that international session. I became a delegate there. And afterwards, you know, I've always been the trainer type of person. I didn't ever like to be a delegate. I've always liked to be the trainer. And the trainer, the coach, is the one that helps the other delegates to get to a resolution. Basically, for the ones that are not familiar to this kind of project, European Youth Parliament, like any UN, you have delegations made out of students from all over the country, or in case Europe, from all over Europe. They get together, they receive a topic on politics. It can be economy, international relations, war, security studies, gender equality, environment. It can be any contemporary topic. They give you a problem. You need to get a solution. A solution means a resolution. So that committee gets together, those 12 delegates, it's usually 12, get together, and they, after attending it, they start debating on how they can solve that problem. At the end of those debates, you get a resolution. And that's the one that eventually, in the last day of the conference, gets to be presented in front of the other committees. And at the same time, it gets voted to be passed or not to be passed. In case of the European Youth Parliament, the resolutions that get to be passed, they are actually sent to the European Parliament. And I'm sure you all have heard of the Erasmus project, right? Erasmus came out from a UYP resolution, from the European Youth Parliament resolution. So it's actually the project of young people as you. So that non-governmental organization actually have some, like get some good solutions for our world. So that's what I used to do. I used to get into those conferences all over Europe, international sessions, national sessions. You also have forums. But as I said, although I had to be a delegate at first, because that's the first, you know, you have to go step by step, afterwards I became a chair, and that was something that I really loved to do. I really enjoyed getting the other delegates to get the best of themselves and to create that resolution that could actually provide reasonable solutions to the problem that was given to us.
But is that based more, like you were saying earlier, on arbitration?
No, that's pure politics.
Okay.
That's pure politics. It's like contemporary politics.
Okay.
It's like problems from security, like starting from security, war, gender equality, environment, economics, like things that the European Parliament is facing as well. like problems that are assigned to them, they just send it to us. So I know it might sound funny that people who are 16 or 17 discuss this kind of topics, but to be honest, I've seen some resolutions that I've never seen from the European Parliament. So, yeah, young people can be very, very pragmatic sometimes. Okay, yeah, I'm not sure if I would explain it in the way you here in the US have it. Because legal action is what you do in the court. Mediation is outside the court. It's having you and the other side in front of a mediator who's completely neutral. He's not going to tell you what you have to do. He's just going to listen to your problems. And in order for you to understand, let me tell you the best thing that I got from mediation. When you have two sides, and can I use your phone?
Yeah.
Do you mind? Thank you. You have two sides on a table, and you're the mediator just here in between them. And you show the two sides a phone, right? This phone, think you can look at it, you can just think of it as a problem. The problem, the conflict that they have. When you show it like this, the person that you have on this side would only see it from its own side. The other person would see it from his own side, right? What you have to do is to turn the phone so that they can see the problem, the conflict, from both sides, right? So that's what mediation does. Thank you, Christopher. That's what mediation does. Help those two parts to see the problems from the other side as well. And help them get to a solution on their own. They might do it, or they might not do it, but that's their own decision. A mediator would never tell what they have to do. However, in arbitration, or the way arbitration works back in my home country, the arbitrator makes a decision on what they have to do. And that is why I honestly believe in mediation more than I do believe in arbitration. Because I think you can solve a problem by letting the sides do it. If you know how to get them into doing it. If you know how to conduct them into doing it. And let me tell you a short story. It wasn't my mediation. However, it was the mediation of a very good friend who told me this story. He was there into a divorce. The wife and the husband came. They decided to divorce, to get a divorce. And they were fighting over the two cars that I had, as if their boy, their 12-year, I think it was the 12-year-old boy, wasn't the biggest problem, but the cars that they had. One of the cars was a Mercedes, I'm sure you all know. You're recording that, right? I can't really say it. However, the other car was like a cheaper one. Way cheaper one. A Romanian car, okay? Of course, the lady wanted the most expensive one, right? She was acting like a lady. Of course we didn't want the most expensive car, right? She wanted the Mercedes. However, her husband didn't agree with her. He didn't want to give her the Mercedes. What the mediator did, he asked her what she's going to do with that car. Why does she want the car for? And she said, you know, I'm going to take my child because I'm the one who's looking after my child. See, that's why I'm going to get a Mercedes, because I'm taking care of my child. I'm going to take him to school and then back home, and that's it. And then the mediator also asked her, are you working? And she said, no. And then the mediator started to explain her that, you know, when you have a car, you also need to take care of it, or, you know, you also need to buy gas and then take it to, like, every month to check on it. And that takes a lot of money, right? So as soon as the mediator explained all those things to her and made her realize that what's actually good for her, it's the, you know, the cheaper car. That's when all the conflict came to an end. And they got a divorce, but they actually got an agreement on almost everything. So a mediator somehow makes you understand and see the problem from different sides. And, you know, the experience of studying mediation and practicing it and training, I became a trainer in mediation afterwards, made me realize that even in a research, when I do a research, you have to look at the problem, at the topic, at the subject from different sides. It's like a cube, and I was talking with you, remember? It's like a cube. You have a cube and you have to see it from different perspectives. And that's why I strongly support multidisciplinary perspectives. Because when you get to see a topic, for example, let me be on the subject, let me tell you how I see my topic. When I look at terrorism and the reasons why people become terrorists, if I just look from a political point of view, from an international point of view, from an international relations point of view, from a security point of view, I just see one face of the cube. But if I go and ask my friends, you remember we were talking about this today, ask my friends who are anthropologists or economy teachers or other social sciences, and they tell me their point of views on that, I get to see all the sides of the cube. And I'm not saying that I'm getting a perfect 100% view, I'm just saying that I'm getting the closest to reality that I can get. So, you can also understand from what I'm saying right now, the fact that doing other things than just studying a course can help you in the things you do in your daily life and in your future research or in your future job as well. So mediation, when I took the course, I thought I'm just taking it to get a job in case I'm not going to follow the academic path. In fact, it ended up helping me exactly on the pathway that I'm on. So that's what I'm saying. Everything you do in your life, every decision you make, there's something else as well. Every chance that you get and you don't make the best of it, that becomes a curse, you know? Because every train that you miss is not coming back. First thing that they have to do is to point out that they do that, to point out that they are bilingual, that they're fluent in their languages, and that they know how to use them. Like, knowing a language is not enough. Knowing how to use that language in what you do is what you have to do. Like, it's not an advantage for you just knowing more than one language. An advantage for you becomes when you know exactly how to use them to evaluate and to develop. So the first thing to do is to let people know how to do it, and also know how to do it and how to use them. And how to use them in what you're gonna do. And I'm coming back to the same idea. After they choose what they want to do exactly, they would have to decide how to use those languages in what they're going to do. So, and therefore, there's something else as well about being bilingual, is the fact that, I'm not saying it, studies are saying it, people who are bilingual tend to make analogies better and bring solutions to the table in a faster way because their brains tend to work a bit faster. So, you can take an advantage from that as well, and that's just a small advice. I think 1,000 times in my life, I've done it. Like, no matter how this, like, so how strong I was on what I wanted to do, you still get those moments when you're like, oh, still, I want to do that and that and that at the same time, and that would be lovely as well, but no. You just have to take a step back, take a breath in, and relax first. And then try to see everything from the balcony. And that's something that I'm not saying, my mom used to say to me all the time. And I think this is the best advice that she gave me so far. Every time I had a problem or I was a bit confused on what I wanted to do, or you know, as any young person, I used to have problems as well. You know, life is not perfect, I think. So she used to tell me that every time I get into that situation, take a step back, get up on the balcony, and look from there. Try to be objective. I know it's hard. Just try to see yourself from there and realize what actually suits you in an objective way. And that's going to help. It helped for me. Every time I got into that moment of, I know, craziness, I say, when I was like, I don't know exactly what I'm going to do, I went up and I stayed there for a while. I looked at myself, at what I've done so far, I had done so far, and that's how I chose the next step. I can't say it was the best step. I don't know what would have happened if I'd chosen something different. However, I still have trust in my decisions, and I think no one else could. That's a very important thing. I think no one else could have taken a better decision for myself than I did.
I think I was going to be so rich that. Yeah, very, very rich, I am.
There are no real secrets other than work and passion. If we have passion for something, you work with pleasure. I might confess that there have been languages that I wasn't so attracted to. And that's the reason why French, for example, is not my best language. It's just a language that I do use in my research because I can perfectly understand what I read, but talking it has always been a problem for me because I've never felt that attracted to it. However, realizing the importance that those languages have motivated me to doing it. And at the same time, the passion that I felt, especially for the Turkish language and for Arabic, and as regarding Turkish language, Tamer can also say it here because we're talking in Turkish usually. The passion that I had for those two made me want to do more and more and learn and better and better. And also the people that came into my life, the friends that I've made from Turkey and from the Arab countries, made me even more motivated to learn it because the appreciation that I had for them and the love that I had for them as friends motivated me to talk better. So I think it's a multitude of factors and no actual secret. The only way is by work and passion. And if those things, like if passion motivates you, you get to do amazing things. And it's not just in languages, in everything. It depends because I would agree with you if it's like Spanish and French at the same time because they kind of have the same roots and even the same kind of common grammar and common words. However, when you have languages as Turkish and Spanish, which are completely different, it's quite hard to mix among them and to use one as a backup for the other one. And to be honest, when I started Arabic, I realized that I also like Greek language. And I wanted to do a double course, one in Arabic and one in the Greek language. And I did. However, I realized that I'm not being productive. And that is a very important thing as well. When you realize that in what you do, you're not productive, you have to stop. When you realize that you're doing too much and that you're not doing any of these things at the best of your powers, you need to stop. So that's what I did. I stopped from studying the Greek language just because Arabic was my passion and was a better choice for me. And then I became productive. So it's a tricky thing. It depends on the languages that you study at the same time. Teachers have been extremely important in my life. Actually, it was a teacher who got me into the Arab language. And it was a teacher who made me realize that I want to study the Turkish language. You know, actually, my first Turkish class, it started like this. The teacher, who didn't know any English, neither Romanian, just Turkish, came to the classroom and wrote on the board, love and respect. I'm a very emotional person. I do put emotion in my research as well, in my presentations, and in the things I write as well. When I saw those two words, I started to appreciate that person. And by appreciating that person, I got attached to his language as well. And that's how he taught me into the Turkish language. So see, friends, teachers, people that you have in your life, like the things that happen in your life, they do define who you are today. And to be honest, God really sends you the people that you need in your life, being good or bad. Yeah, we need bad people in our lives as well to get us back to reality. And to make us appreciate the good people in our lives. See, it's the way you see, it's the way you look at things. That's a very important thing as well. The way you look at things helps you to make a good decision. Or what you understand by a good decision. Romanian in my class, and even taking a visa for Syria took me ages, unlike my British friends. So being a bit, let's say, worried about how I'm gonna get there and how I'm gonna handle the situation there, made me realize that I might have to somehow contact the embassy that we have there and let them know that I'm coming, so that they can know that I'm there, like any other citizen, Romanian citizen. So I sent my CV to the embassy before I left. And there's a rule, or there used to be, I'm not sure how things are right now, but for our citizens, when you get there, and I think it was the same for the other citizens as well, as in for British people or German people, because they were German students as well. We were supposed to go to our consulates as soon as we get to Syria, in order to give them their passports so that they can register us in to the area. So I went with my Palestinian friend to the embassy, and as soon as I got there, I gave my passport to the policeman in front of it, security officer actually. He took my passport, got it in, and then someone from the Syrian, like from the Romanian embassy in Syria, who now is an ambassador in Qatar, is the Romanian ambassador in Qatar, and who became a very good friend when I was there, and had influenced my career. He saw my passport and remembered that he saw my CV. And I think he was kind of not impressed. I wouldn't say impressed. I would just say that I left something into his memory, or I don't know, when he read my CV, so he just felt that he wanted to meet me. So he invited me in, and talking, explaining what I was doing, what I have done so far, he realized that he needs me for some, like, for some cultural events. I ended up doing like things both in the Romanian embassy and the Turkish embassy, helping the students, the Romanian students there. I became a member of an organization that was the organization of Romanian students abroad who are studying abroad. And I kind of founded that organization in Syria at that time. So those are the things that I did in Syria. I wasn't an official stagiaire, or how you call it, because that's very complicated in Romania. Getting into an embassy, because to be honest, at some point in my life, I was thinking of following this pathway. I was thinking of getting into diplomacy. But then I realized that, unfortunately, coming from communism still makes Romania a very difficult country. So knowing someone somewhere helps you and gets you into a position. Therefore, as I don't really like compromising in any way, I do like compromising in mediation and on real things, but I don't like doing compromises that would compromise me afterwards. I decided that that's not the path that I'm going to take. So what I did in Syria, it wasn't an official job, if you want to take it like that. I did have an official job. I was a translator. I used to translate theses from Arabic to English for different students. But the things that I did in the Syrian, in the embassy, Romanian embassy in Syria, or the relations that I got from there, knowing people, getting to know people, did help me into understanding the area more and the international relations of the area. I think I wouldn't recommend it anyway, because do you know why? Because every time I tend to recommend something happens. So, see, that's the problem with our topic nowadays. Like, for people who study the Middle East and those contemporary issues, that's our problem. You might write something today and end up burning that paper tomorrow. So I think it's really tricky to recommend something. Because the situation there is underdeveloping all the time, is resuming and resuming all the time. So saying that you should do this and this and this doesn't really help, because I'm not there at the same time. Like, someone who would be there, like, physically there, would be able to tell more and to give solutions more than I can. The only thing that I do, I look at the way people get seduced by those organizations. And I'm looking at the way they do it, so that I can help create a strategy to get to them before the others do. And I'm not saying to get them in, I'm just saying tricking them from this terrorism. I was studying the NSA, which is the Modern Standard Arabic, which is a very formal language, and to be honest, I don't see it spoken unless it is on TV or in official debates. And I think the way to really get to know the culture, the Arab culture, is by speaking the dialect, because that's the language of the people. So I knew exactly that I'm supposed to choose a dialect in order to actually get into that culture, into that community as well. And then I looked and listened to the dialects that I could learn. And that was, if I wanted to go to Jordan, the Jordanian accent, which is not very much different from the Syrian one. And then I listened. I used to have many friends, Arab friends, in my first year of university back in the UK, and I owe them a lot, definitely, for what I am today. And they gave me the chance to hear Palestinian accent, Syrian accent, Egyptian accent, Saudi accent. And the one that I felt attached to was the Syrian accent. And as I said, it's not just that, it's also the proximity to Turkey. And there's a teacher as well. It's always been a teacher. The Arabic teacher that I had back in Romania, she studied in Syria as well. So I think I kept that in my mind. And it really had a big role within my decision to go to Syria. And as I said, it was the best decision I made.